Dear beloved Muslims, assalamu alaikum. أعوذ بالله أعوذ بالله أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شر أنفسنا ومن سيئاتنا أعمالنا من يهدي الله فلا مضل له ومن يضل فلا هادي له أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله لا شريك لك وأشهد أن محمد عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وسلم. I bear witness in the name of Allah. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. I bear witness that there is no one worthy of worship but Allah, the all-wise, true, and living God. And I bear witness that the Prophet Muhammad, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, is his true servant and his last apostle. So with that, I'd like to greet the believers here at Ali Khan Islamic Center with the greetings of peace and paradise of Assalamu Alaikum. Today, dear Muslims, I'm going to read from chapter 13, ayat 11. And it says here, Allahu la ligayru ma yaqawmi l-hatta bigayri man bi anfusihim wa idha aradallahu bi qawmin su'an falamma radallahu wa ma lakum min adunihim min waliyan. It says that surely Allah the Most High, He changes not the condition of a people unless those people change that which is in their nafs, that which is with inside of themselves, their thinking, their attitude, the thoughts and the actions that ensue from that thinking. It is the way of Allah, the way of fitrah, the way of natural growth, to take His creature, His creation, from stage to stage to stage. That's His way. That has always been His way. That is always what He wanted for us, is to take His creation and involve, take it, that creation that He made, His highest form of creation, and evolve it from stage to stage to stage. You follow me? But there's a duty on that creature, or that creation, to follow certain steps of growth. You know, the last four or five khutbahs that I've done, I've talked about taqwa. Taqwa meaning, if you just want to loosely translate it, is God consciousness, God awareness, being in the presence of Allah to the point that we see and hear, smell, touch, and taste only Allah. That's taqwa. It's not just a concept or ideology. It is a living reality where one sees, feels, touches, feels, and tastes Allah. But at the same time, we know, or we have to understand, that the state or the step of taqwa, or arriving to taqwa, involves work. It involves a commitment, a resolve within the heart, and a resolve within the mind to serve Allah and only Allah. So with taqwa, we have three basic elements. We have the element of trust, because Allah loves those who put their trust in Him. That's first. The Bible says, trust in the Lord with all of your heart and rely not upon your own understanding. So this is what Allah wants of us first. He wants us to trust His wisdom, His guidance, His understanding. He wants us to trust, to have trust in Him. Second, He requires of us sabur, or patience. Patience is necessary to develop the muscle of trust. You have to have patience. Each and every day, each and every moment, each and every second, Allah the Most High tasks us or challenges us with patience. He loves the patient. He supports the patient. He blesses the patient. You see, so he loves, so far, two things. He loves those who put their trust in him, who rely on him, as it is spoken of over and over and over and over and over and over again in the Quran. He loves those who trust him. He loves those who are patient. And the last one is he loves those who show gratitude. So it is those three elements basically that fortify or strengthen us or bring us to the level of taqwa. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, the Quran has in it an open meaning, a meaning that it is open. It has within it a meaning that is hidden. So you have open meaning. You have a hidden meaning. You have a meaning that's on the surface, that's open, that's clear to all. A meaning that when the son of Adam reads it, he takes it as being clear truth or clear evidence, so there will be no doubt in his mind of what his duty is or what our duty is to obtain taqwa. So it's clear. When Allah says, commands us to make zakat, it's clear. Not ambiguous. He means just that. Pay zakat. He means that. When he says make salat or make prayer, that's what he means. He means that. No ambiguity. When he tells a story of a people, a historical account, the account is just the way he said it was. True, it has its symbolic references to it, but if he says that Joseph, peace be upon him, was cast into a well and picked up by travelers, that's exactly what he means. And the prophets did exist, and those stories did happen. So there's an open meaning that's clear. Then there's this hidden meaning. A hidden meaning that is arrived at through acts of devotion, through Quranic reading, through the practice of zikrullah. And then Allah opens up the gates to his unseen world and gives us the hidden meaning, because it comes from Allah and only Allah. We may think that it comes from us. We may think that we may be able to intellectually or logically deduce his secrets, but it comes from only Allah. The more we read the Quran, recite the Quran, the more that we practice the practice of zikrullah, the remembrance of Allah, the more and more we arrive at his hidden meaning of the book. It has open meaning. It has a hidden meaning. It has limits, and it has steps. Okay? It has limits. We have what they call a sharia or a law, where Allah tells us how far we can go. Excuse me. And then there are steps that take us up into levels higher levels that don't end in this life but continue on into the next life. So I read this particular ayat in reference to the measure or the exercise that will help take us from one step to the next. Because, you know, bringing it in real time. Okay, listen now. Bringing it into real time situation. Individually and mostly collectively with regard to this community, this Ummah of those who attend Ali Khan Islamic Center, we are at the threshold of moving into a new phase. The signs are all there. You all see the signs. You see what's going on here. We're in the point of moving to a new phase, a new level, because this is what Allah wants. He doesn't want stagnation. He doesn't want us to just stay at one point. He wants us to move from stage to stage to stage to stage. That's what he wants of us. So, in order to do so, we cannot evolve unless we change something that's in our nafs. Now, the scholars, according to the Quranic point of view, give three types of what they call levels of the soul, stages of the soul. The first one is called Nafs el Amara. Nafs el Amara is when the soul is at a stage or in a condition where it is relatively unchecked or under the influence of the passions. Is under the influence of the passion of greed, lust, selfishness, bigotry, hatred. Is subjected to these passions. And when the soul is in this condition, the soul is more so on the level of an animal, lower than the level of an animal, when it's under the subjection of its passions, of its low desires. That is Nafs el Amara. The second stage or step of the soul is a level called Nafs el Lawama. Nafs el Lawama is the stage when the soul begins a battle. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam was asked about what is the greatest jihad. And the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi responded, your greatest jihad is when you take the battle against your own self, against our own nafs. So in this particular stage, to go there is a battle that takes place. If you want to say the battle between good and evil, you can say that. Or the battle between conquering or limiting the base desires or not, you're never going to get rid of them. Never. There's always going to be an urge for the lower desires. But that's not the aim. The aim is not to totally eliminate it because they're part of our creation. But there can be limits. There are limits and there's steps. Their limits, their steps. So when we're on that plane, we begin this battle with the soul. Battle with the lower desires that the shaitan continuously prompts us to follow. So we begin that battle. So in the course of that battle, or in the ensuance of that battle, we come into what we say is religious practices, which is a brace or a measure to help us maintain or overcome the desires of the lower self. You know, last week, a Christian, I guess he was a pastor, came in here. You may have seen him. And he was looking for some understanding, okay? So I sat back there with him in the back room for about 2 hours. And he asked me about your experience, or why did you become a Muslim? And I was, and my response to him is, one of the reasons I became a Muslim was not so much to cast aside my Christian upbringing. It had nothing to do with the strong morals and values that I was taught in the church, because they were good, strong moral values. As a matter of fact, values that a lot of, that we need today, that we kind of like got away from, those values. But I accepted Islam because, well, actually, I didn't accept it. It was Allah appointed me. Allah wanted me here. And he wanted me here, as with many of us, is because that I had challenges, demons, or whatever you want to call them, just like you all, that could not be maintained or could not be put under control, not unless I had some sort of discipline or restraint that Islam enforced, insisted upon. I couldn't do it by myself, and Allah knew that. Now, there are some good people who are just born good-natured. They won't lie. They were just born like that as a gift from Allah. They won't lie, or it's against their nature to lie. They won't steal. They won't backbite. They won't cheat, you see, because it's their nature. And they may not necessarily need the degree of discipline that Islam encourages or enforces, but they do still need some sort of guidance. So, but anyway, the soul in Nafs al-Lawwama is at that point when the soul begins this battle. We go through Ramadan. And during Ramadan, one of our major disciplines is to contain or control those passions, those lower desires, the desires of the flesh and the desires of the mind, both. Because our lower desires don't necessarily mean something that involves the flesh. It also means something that involves the thinking, our thoughts, and these sort of things. The very last stage that we get to is the stage of victory. Once we have undergone this jihad of the soul, eventually we get to a point of victory. And when we're at that point of victory, is called the stage of Nafs al-Mutma'ina, or the soul is at rest. Because the first two stages, Nafs al-Amara, the soul is definitely not at rest. It's pretty much on fire. The second stage that it gets to is sometimes you are and sometimes you're not. You see, sometimes we see Allah, sometimes we don't. But that last particular stage, the soul is completely at rest, because at this point, and only this point, does it realize it's La ilaha illallah, that there's no God but Allah. That when they see only Allah. When we hear, We hear only Allah. When we think our thoughts, we only see the thoughts of Allah. Feel the thoughts of Allah. So that is nafs al-mutma'ina, the soul that is completely rest, has nothing to worry about. Because in la ilaha, when you realize it's la ilaha illallah, there's nothing that exists to save Allah. What's there to worry about? So you have those three stages. You have nafs al-amara, the soul that is in under complete domination of the lower passions of the body and the mind. You have nafs al-lawama, where this battle, this jihad, this greater jihad, jihad al-akbar, as the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam referred to it as jihad al-akbar, the great jihad, the jihad where the soul begins to battle against itself, to master itself. And then you have this, the last stage of nafs al-mutma'ina. In nafs al-mutma'ina is when the battle has become complete. Some you just can't imagine or think or fool ourselves to believe we're at this stage, and really we're not. We can't try and convince others that we're at this stage where we're running around, we're worried, we're angry, you know, we're under the domination of things of the lower self. Because that nafs al-mutma'ina is nothing but total peace. When we get to this particular stage of nafs al-mutma'ina, according to the judgment of Allah, we can choose rather to transcend on or stay here. We have a choice. Give us that choice. We come here for a certain time. That time can be stretched, not necessarily mean linear years, but time according to Allah. That time can be either stretched or shortened, depending upon the condition of our soul. In nafs al-mutma'ina, we can choose. When we get to that point, those special souls that make it there can make a choice. Can make a choice to return to Allah, to enter His paradise and His kingdom, or stay here and be a guide. Most choose to stay here and be a guide until such a point where they just can't function here anymore. You see, and we'll know when that time comes. We'll always know. It says, well, it's no use in me. I can't stay here anymore. I got all these physical problems. I can't get out of bed. I'm depending on people for this, that, and the other. I'm ready to go at that particular point. But most who have reached that stage of nafs al-mutma'ina make a choice to stay here and guide in order to earn more favors of Allah. That's nafs al-mutma'ina. Okay? Says in the Quran. This is chapter 276. A'udhu billahi minash shaitani rajim. Bismillahir rahmanir rahim. Yamhaqullahu riba wa yarba sadqah. Wallahu la yuhibbu kulli kaffarin nadhim. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. It says here, Allah will blot out usury and He will cause charity to prosper. And Allah loves not any ungrateful sinner. Listen carefully. It says that Allah will blot out usury and He will cause sadaqat to increase. Loosely translated as charity. Allah is not a liar. When He gives us a living truth, He will manifest it. There's not an idle or a word of untruth in this book. I haven't found it. I've been reading this book for quite a little while now. Okay? And I have found that in time, Allah will manifest His truth. If we doubt it, or we have second thoughts about it, He's going to manifest the truth. Oh, He'll do it. Hopefully it comes before the time we can't change our thinking. But He will manifest our truth. Let's talk about sadaqat. Okay, let's talk about sadaqat. Or free giving. You know, now let's put the nuts and bolts. Now let's talk a little nuts and bolts now. Nuts and bolts here. At this stage, like I said before, this community is at a threshold of moving from one step of one stage to the next. We may have already moved from one stage. Talk to me. But then there's another stage. And a stage after that. Now this next stage that we're moving into, Allah is giving us an opportunity. Because it comes from Him. If Allah gives us the opportunity to move from one stage to the next, it's because of Him, not because of our own efforts. We just can't say, well, we want to move to the next stage by ourselves. Because it is from Allah and only from Allah. He gives us an invitation to move from one stage to the next. He gives us an invitation when He wants to invite us into the unseen world and show us things that we may not be able to comprehend. It is by His invitation. Only Allah. La ilaha illallah. You see, so we're at that stage now where we're getting ready to move from one stage to the next. Now, in moving from this stage, from one stage to the next, the question of a facility comes up. Because obviously, let's face it, this community has grown within the last year, has grown to the point where this space, even though we expanded this space by the grace of Allah, we still need more space, which Allah knows. He knows this. He has all this math. He has it all worked out before we even came in our mind. So we're moving to the next stage. Now, in moving to the next stage, the question comes up. Well, if we're going to move to the next stage, how are we going to get there? There are various ways. Everybody has their own understanding, which may be a good understanding of just how to get there. But if we study the example of the model of those that have been at where we at, to where they got to, where they got to go, they all began with the model of sadaqah. They all did it. First Baptist, Waycross, Lakewood Community Church, these humongous mega churches started out right here. That's where they started out. We say, well, sadaqah, what's that going to do? Well, it does this. There are two components to sadaqat. Sadaqat, especially in reference to this particular verse that I just read, it says that Allah will cause the sadaqat to grow. And He speaks the truth. He said, read it for yourself. Surah 2,
276. He says, Allah will blot out usury, and that's a whole nother subject, and he will cause sadaqat to increase. Brothers, could you kindly move up, you know, because we're cramped for space. Okay, so kindly move up. Okay, I really appreciate that. Thank you very much. He will cause sadaqah to increase if it's given with the right intent. Especially after the soul has gone through the purification process of the nafs. The higher up we go on our personal and our inner development, the more powerful and effective that sadaqah becomes. These examples are in the Quran. I didn't put them there. Example, one person will give a dollar in the name of Allah and just eventually yield the rewards of $10. Another person will give in the name of Allah a dollar and Allah will reward him with $1,000. Another person may give in the name of Allah with the purest of intent, $1. And as a result of that, Allah will bless him with $1 million in return. But all of this depends upon the degree of sincerity and the degree of the soul. In my thinking, when a person that gives $10 for the sake of Allah, for the sake of pleasing Allah, for the sake of granting mercy on the day of resurrection, it's better off the person that gives $1 million without that intent. So Allah looks at that intent. Why did you give it? Did you do this? Did you give this money to please me? Or did you get it just so that you could be, someone can say something grand or to be seen of men? So there are two things that happen. There's the giver and there's the receiver. When I say the giver, the person that gives with the right intent, and the receiver, and I'm talking about the bureaucracy, which I'm a part of here, in the spirit of the receiver. If one gives with the intent to please Allah and only Allah, and it is received in the same spirit in which it has been given, then that sadaqah begins to increase and grow and grow and grow. This is fitrah. This deen or this religion has often been referred to as deen el-fitrah, or the natural religion. Fitrah being that Allah in his way of creation can take the most smallest minute thing and turn it into the grandest of things. That's how he does it. That's the way he's always done it. That's the way he always will do it. So we cannot rule out the effectiveness of sadaqah, because it'll grow with all these great churches. This is how they started. This is how they got them churches. These big structures, these big congregations, they started right there. So, this is not a sales pitch, but it is a encouragement to increase our sadaqah for the sake of Allah. If you want to give to our building fund, which we have a building fund, an expansion fund here, for the intent of attaining a new facility to accommodate our growth, then do it for the sake of Allah. Whatever you give, no amount is too small. It's the intent that counts. So, Let us not forget our sadaqah. Let us continue to practice the spirit of sadaqah. Now, usury, I'm going to talk about that some other time because we all don't agree just exactly what it is. But it's not a, believe me, it is not a good thing. And I have learned that the hard way. It is not a good thing to be in. Not at all. Here you are paying a mortgage for the last 20 years, and every time you look at your statement, it looks like you haven't hardly made a dent. You all know what I'm talking about. You've been there. That's usury. That's what usury brings. So that's all I want to say about usury. So now, we're getting short on time. I want to make a few announcements. Second part of the khutbah, I'm just going to do a prayer, so don't think you're going to be here all night because you're not. You know how I roll, okay? Now, the first thing I want to do is I want to welcome my guest here, okay? Brother Sultan over here, I know he's humble, you know, just be humble like you always are. And my good sister Katie back there, I have known them forever. He made Hajj with us way 40 years ago. Okay, I knew him back in Boston. I'm glad that you all could be here with us. Okay, Brother Sultan and Sister Katie. You know, people that you haven't seen for a long time that you kind of grew up with, they become your treasures after a period of time. So we welcome you here, Sultan, and hopefully this won't be your last time here. If you want to, move on down here, brother, you know, when you retire, of course. Okay, now, and I also want to welcome my other guests that are here for the first time. We welcome you here, and we appreciate the fact that you have chosen to come to Ali Khan Islamic Center. We appreciate you, and we appreciate everything. Every dollar that you drop in that bucket, we appreciate it. So thank you. Time is running on. Tomorrow we have a men's meeting from 10 to 12 here at the Masjid for the men. We sit down and discuss issues. It's a free-for-all thing, but we discuss things. Taqlim, we have Taqlim on Sunday from 10 to 12. Okay, Taqlim. Okay, I'd like to thank, since he's, I just saw him back here, Khalil Shadid. You know, I'd like to thank you for your fundraising effort that you did at the CTV studio. Thank you very much. You see, it's like I say, efforts like that, they grow, they expand. They don't just stay on one level, they grow. So we appreciate that. Along with that, Brother Akbar is going to have a fish fry tomorrow here at the Masjid around noon, and he needs assistance. You know Brother Akbar. There he is right there. Raise your hand. Okay. Oh, okay, that's Akbar. Okay, now we also want to make a dua or a prayer for our sister Jamila. I think she was back there some time ago. Oh, she left. We want to make a prayer for her. You know, her son is hospitalized, and he needs our thoughts in our prayers. And now this one here, I don't have too much specifics on it, so I really can't read it. So with that, thank you very much. Okay. All right, we'll do it, but just Hamza, from now, if you just raise your hand, I know what you're talking about. Okay, we want to avoid speaking out in the khutbah. Okay, we want to avoid that. So we want to remember our Muslim journal, and we also want to remind people that because of the space of the crowd, our brother Hamza Abdul Hamid does a second khutbah, which starts maybe about 15 minutes after this one. So with that, you know, I thank you very much. May Allah continue to bless us in our internal growth and spiritual growth. Assalamu alaikum. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد فاته لما ولق والقاتل لما سبق ناصر الحق بالحق والهادي إلى صراطك مستقيم وعلى آله حق قدره ومقداره العظيم سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون والسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين آمين أقم الصلاة.